We arose out of the need 30 years ago, and this was the need that our founders saw, the small group of academics and activists who felt that we needed a real counterweight to neoliberal forces, which were gaining ascendance at the time.
We had the Business Council on National Issues, all of the big Canadian corporations. We had right-wing commentators. We had the Fraser Institute, the so-called research body that's really just produces propaganda. And there was a great volume of noise, but all of that noise was from a very narrow channel. And there was not enough ability to respond to that volume of noise all saying the same thing in a slightly different way, which is that social safety nets should be weakened and the rights of corporations should be strengthened, all of the stuff that we've unfortunately grown too used to. So we knew we had the talent, we knew we had ability and skill to counter that, but we didn't have the ability to bring that talent to the fore. People were isolated in their campuses, they were isolated in their unions, they were isolated in their research groups. And what the idea was a very brilliantly simple one. And I can say that because it wasn't mine, I wish it had been. But the idea was to provide a platform where all of those voices of progressive thought and progressive analysis and progressive policy could come together and create a different kind of critical mass so that there was a platform for them and their voices could be heard, speaking truth to this cacophony of noise that was all right-wing propaganda disguised as truth.
Now we are in full flight. We have come of age. We are an essential anchor to the progressive movement across the country. We are well connected and embedded in progressive civil society with labor organizations, women's groups, Aboriginal groups, etc. A wide range of civil society organizations rely on, depend on, and work with us.
For 30 years, the Canadian Centre for Policy Alternatives has been contributing to the debate that goes on right here at Parliament Hill. Whether the topic is employment insurance, free trade deals, environmental policy, CCPA is there providing reliable information that more and more people have come to trust.
The CCPA is absolutely crucial to Canada. For a democracy, we need ideas, new ideas that respond to changing reality. But we need these ideas to be grounded in terms of perspective on what's good for the ordinary person or the poor.
It's about bringing forward and requiring our parliamentarians to think about us, to think about citizens, to think about not just our economic needs, but our needs for a society in which all of us can prosper and improve.
And that's what the CCPA does. It provides ideas, it provides thought, it provides research. So this is important for its own sake. Political parties apart, who exist apart from the CCPA, if they're wise, use their material. And in addition to that positive role, it acts as a counterweight to more conservative research bodies like the Fraser Institute or the Conference Board. So it has been profoundly important for the political life of Canada, and I hope it continues to be so.
Our website, which is the main way we distribute and disseminate our work, gets a lot of traffic. Approximately 150 to 200,000 downloads of our publications occur every month. Our channel on YouTube, our TV channel on YouTube, is the most popular, the most visited of any non-governmental organization in Canada. We also have the largest membership in Canada. We have 12,000 individual members and 300 to 400 organizational members.
And together, they form the center's very heart and spirit. The CCPA Monitor is primarily an information service for our members. I'm understandably biased, of course, when it comes to the Monitor, but I truly believe that the powerful ideas and arguments that it puts forward comprise a package of progressive thinking that can't be found anywhere else.
The economic and political center of gravity in this country is much more provincial, much more subnational than almost any other country in the world. And a few years ago, As a result of studying that and looking at it, we decided that we could no longer serve as a truly national organization from a small national base. We needed to be positioned across the country in the provinces.
For us, it's a real strength to our center to have our provincial offices leading the way on provincial policy. It's absolutely essential, and it's been an invaluable contribution to our strength as an organization.
Well, I think the origins of the alternative federal budget were when we had the Chrétien-Martin government, and they moved very rapidly towards an agenda of very rapidly cutting our way out of deficits and debt. And the alternative budget was a hugely important sort of counterweight to the argument that we really had no alternative but to cut spending. And the main message that we had was we could grow our way out of deficits and debt with much less harm to our social programs. We built a lot of support for that argument, and we engaged very closely with the politicians of the day. And I remember we had one very long meeting with Paul Martin. It was quoted as saying this was very, very good, and he loved to debate. And he debated with us for an hour and a half when people were desperately trying to get his attention because two of the big banks had announced a merger. It was quite bizarre. We left this meeting. There was wall-to-wall cameras and lights, and we'd been talking about the alternative budget for an hour and a half while this political storm was going on outside.
You know, in fact, we've provided better budget estimates than even the government itself. We own that. We've been on top of all of the major policy issues that have been debated in Ottawa. In fact, we've been in front of them.
Well, I think back to when Canada headed into the global Great Recession, our economy really fell off a cliff in October of 2008. And as part of the alternative federal budget, there was a framework document that came out then that was really making the case for a major stimulus package. Support for employment insurance, investment and job creation to help us get through the recession. And as that was going on, of course, the Liberals and the New Democrats with the outside support from the Bloc came together around an alternative economic package, which I think hugely reflected the themes that had been laid out by the alternative budget document. And I think we really held down one side of an intellectual debate there, became a really important point of reference. And then, of course, the federal government did change track quite significantly, brought down the budget after they'd prorogued the House. And it certainly wasn't everything we had wanted, but there was a major infrastructure investment package, some modest improvements to employment insurance. But it was the way in which the CCPA sort of framed that debate that it became a really important point of reference for the media, for politicians. And well, I think that was really our finest hour to date when it comes to the alternative federal budget and the ability of the Canadian Centre for Policy Alternatives to shape the debate.
I often think of what we do as kind of shining the light on the darkness, and I'm reminded of Bruce Coburn's line, "Kick at the darkness till it bleeds daylight." That's kind of where I see the role of the center, as shining the light, lifting the veil of darkness.
Sometimes